Good morning. Good morning, everybody. Have you said good morning to your friends and loved ones next to you? I hope you have. Good morning, friends. I hope somebody here got some friends. Y'all got some friends? A lot of friends? Can Jesus say that you are his friend? Can God say that you are his friend? Well, he is yours. So if I were you, I'd just grab onto him and I would claim him as a friend of mine. There is no friend like Jesus. Come on and worship with us. Who am I that you are mindful of me, that you hear me when I call? Is it true that you are thinking of me, how you love me? It's amazing. Say, who am I, oh Lord?
Who am I that you are mindful of me?
That you hear
me? That you love me?
When I call.
When I call.
Is it true, Lord?
Is it true that you are thinking of me?
How you love me?
How you love me?
It's amazing.
It's amazing.
Say, I am a friend of God.
I am a friend of God.
Can you put your hands together?
I am a friend of God.
Declaring that you're a friend of God.
I am a friend of God. He calls me friend.
I am a friend of God.
I am a friend of God.
Say, I am a friend of God.
I am a friend of God.
I am a friend of God.
I am a friend of God. He calls me friend.
Love me, that you hear me,
that you hear me
when I call,
when I call.
Is it true, Lord?
Is it true that you
that you're thinking of me,
me?
How you,
how
love,
you
me?
Love me,
it's amazing.
It's amazing.
Friend, God Almighty, Lord of glory, you have called me friend. Can you say God Almighty? Go. God
Almighty,
Lord of glory.
Lord,
you're the Lord of glory.
Lord.
morning.
Good morning.
Will all of you bow your heads with me in a word of prayer? Dear God, thank you for waking us up this morning in our right mind. Thank you for your traveling graces, and I pray for those who are traveling elsewhere on this great morning. Protect us in your arms and keep us safe through the highways and byways of life. Lord, we thank you for another day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
He sees the tears you cry.
He shares
your pain inside.
Sometimes
you wonder why he allows you to go through what you go through.
Just know he has his hands on you.
He said he'll see you through.
And when you cry,
he's holding you.
So just lift your hands up high, for he will provide.
Just know he has his hands on you.
He said he'll see you. And when you cry,
he's holding you.
So just lift your hands up high, for he will provide.
Just know.
Good morning, 6th Avenue. Christian King is a rising senior who attends Gardendale High School, a product of the Jefferson County School System. He is active in the theater arts program and was awarded the most outstanding theater arts student this past school year. He is also a member of the Chamber Choir. In February, Christian competed in the Bevel State Community College Torch Invitational, where he won first place in the male vocal solo competition. He was awarded a summer torch scholarship to cover the tuition for a 3-hour course for the summer semester. After graduating from high school, Christian plans to attend college and major in musical theater. Ladies and gentlemen, Christian King.
This, all nations in him are blessed. All things are done by his will. He spoke to the sea and the sea stood still. Now ain't that a witness for my Lord? Ain't that a witness for my Lord? Ain't that a witness for my Lord? My soul's a witness for my Lord. There was a man of the Pharisees. His name was Nicodemus and he didn't believe. The same came to Christ by night, wanted to be taught out of human sight. Nicodemus was a man desired to know how a man could be born if he is old. Christ told Nicodemus as a friend, man, you must be born again. Then you'll be a witness for my Lord. You'll be a witness for my Lord. You'll be a witness for my Lord. Saul is a witness for my Lord. You read about Samson from his birth, strongest man who ever lived on earth. Way back yonder in ancient times, he killed 10,000 of the Philistines. Even Samson went wandering about. Samson's strength was never found out. Till his wife sat upon his knee, he said, "Tell me where your strength lies, if you please." Samson's wife, she talked so fair. Samson said, "Cut off of my hair, shave my head just as clean as your head, and my strength will come like a natural man." Oh, Samson was a witness for my Lord. Samson was a witness for my Lord. Samson was a witness for my Lord. Saul is a witness for my Lord. There's another witness. Now there's another witness. There's another witness. My soul is a witness for my Lord. My soul is a witness for my Lord.
Oh, praise the Lord. Christian King. I told Christian, I didn't know you could sing like that. Man, just smooth and effortless. Praise the Lord.
Good morning, 6th Avenue. I'm Avery Robinson, a member of the Intermediate Liturgical Dance Ministry. Today, Kelsey Robinson, my sister, and Taylor Player will perform their senior dance to Love Theory by Kirk Franklin, a song about God's unconditional love for us all. We truly serve an awesome God, and he has blessed us in so many ways. His blessings and forgiveness are never ending. Even when we don't deserve his grace, regardless of our sins, no matter what, God always welcomes us with open arms. To each of you, especially the graduating seniors starting the next chapter of your lives, remember God's promise in Matthew 19:26. Jesus looked at them and said, "With man, this is impossible, but with God, all things are possible." I hope you all are blessed by Kelsey and Taylor's choreography. Be blessed.
Brothers and sisters, I want to welcome you back to life, back to the one that can make your next chapter your best chapter. Hallelujah.
How can it be that you love the most unlovable part of me? Of me. How could you see your life was the only gift? Nobody but you.
That's right.
I don't wanna love. love nobody
yes. And the church saying, come on. Jesus loving you
will be the death of me.
It sounds crazy, don't it?
Hey. That's how it's supposed to be.
Let me tell you what it means.
More of you, less of me.
That's why.
I don't wanna love nobody but you. I don't wanna love nobody but you.
Father,
I don't wanna love nobody but you.
I really mean it this time.
I don't wanna love nobody but you. I don't wanna love nobody but you.
Let me tell you what it does.
Oh, let's give them a hand again. Praise the Lord. You know, that was, they're both seniors. And that was their last dance at 6th Avenue. Man, it's hard to believe how time passes so quickly. All right. Thank you, Avery. All right. Now, oh, yeah. They're young. They can run. And they can come right back in here after going, doing all of that. Praise the Lord. All right. We want to congratulate them and present them with these bouquet of flowers. And, get my heart, yeah. So, we want to say to you ladies, remember where you come from, and remember whose you are. This church will always support you, will always love you, and you can always come back here, and we'll be praying for you. So, congratulations on graduating, and we look forward to God richly blessing you in the future. All right? All right, take care. God bless, God bless. Amen, amen.
Come on, put your hands together. Let's praise the Lord. I'm so glad. Hey, 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 trouble don't last always. Can I get a witness? I'm so, oh yes I am. Troubles don't last always. I'm so glad. Oh yes I am. Troubles don't last always. He may not come when you want him, but he's on time. In times of trouble, I found him to be a friend of mine. When storm clouds rise in your life, he'll be there, yes he will. Your burdens, I know the Lord will help you to bear. I'm so, oh yes I am, that troubles don't last always. Can I get a witness? I'm so, hey, 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 troubles don't last always. Let me say it again. I say he may not come when you want him, but I'm a witness he'll be on time. And if times are trouble, I found him to be a friend of mine. And when storm clouds rise in your life, he'll be there, yes he will. And every one of your burdens, I know the Lord will help you to bear. I'm so, oh yes I am, that troubles don't last always. Can I get a witness, say I'm so, hey, 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 troubles don't last always. faith, yeah, everything will be, it's gonna be all right. It's gonna be all right. It will be all right. Everybody on your feet, if you know God will make a way for you, stand up and praise the Lord. No matter what you're going through, I'm a living witness, my God will make a way for you. Soprano sing. Troubles don't last always. Troubles don't last always.
Thank you. like you, Jesus. Can't nobody do me like Jesus. Ain't nobody nowhere. Jesus. How excellent. Ooh, hallelujah. Is that name.
Let the church say amen. Jesus is excellent, and one day at his name every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that he is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. My brothers and sisters, this morning I would like to turn for you to turn in your Bibles to Romans the 10th chapter. Romans chapter 10, and we're going to start with verse 6. And you know, for those of you who like to turn in your Bibles, I want you to keep your Bibles open. I'm going to go through quite a few scriptures today. You know, sometimes, periodically, I will do that because it becomes more like a Bible study almost. But I want us to look at the scriptures today, and I want to talk about something that I think is very important and something that I've been building up to as we've talked about the enemies as we've talked about the enemy for the past few weeks. So if you would, Romans chapter 10, it's right there on the screen, beginning with verse 6 from the Word of God. But the righteousness that is by faith says, do not say in your heart, who will ascend into heaven, that is to bring Christ down, or who will descend into the deep, that is to bring Christ up from the dead. But what does it say? And then he quotes the Old Testament scripture. He says, the word is near you. It is in your mouth and in your heart. that is the message concerning faith that we proclaim. If you declare with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For it is with your heart that you believe and are justified, and it is with your mouth that you profess your faith and are saved. May the Lord bless the hearing and the reading of his holy word. Let the people of God say amen. 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 Let's just pause for a word of prayer. Eternal God, our Father, we're just thankful for this moment where we're able to share with one another in the word of God. Even though I'm the preacher, may I simultaneously be the listener. And I pray that even as I'm up here, teach me, Lord, even as I desire that you teach your people. I ask that our hearts might be open to receive this word. And even as Moses ascended on the mountain and in humility he took off his shoes and he bowed down before you, likewise, in the same manner, Lord, symbolically, we bow down before you and we ask that you would speak to us. Speak to us right now in the name of Jesus. Let the church say amen. Amen. This morning, my brothers and sisters, I want to talk to you about the importance of a good confession. All right, I'm not talking about salvation. I know what the text said. But I want to talk about the importance of a good confession, the importance of opening your mouth and proclaiming and or confessing what it is you believe. So now, when we looked at the book of Romans in the 10th chapter, it really says to us, I don't know if you noticed this or not, but I want to bring this out, that there are two aspects of salvation. There are two aspects to a person being saved. When we look at verse 9, it says, if you declare with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Then he goes on to explain it. The first aspect is this. It is with your heart that you believe and are justified. And the second aspect, it is with your mouth that you profess and are saved. So your mouth professes what your heart believes. So it's not just about believing in your heart that Jesus is Lord, but it is very important, my brothers and sisters, to open your mouth and declare what you believe in order to complete the process. Very much like a person says, you know, I want Jesus to be my Lord and Savior, and they come and join the church. Well, that's not all. Because from there, we take them to the pool, and they are baptized, and that completes the process. And so, you know, from the very beginning of our Christian experience, it is important not only to have it in your heart, but it's important for you to say what it is you believe. All right? So now, the other thing I want you to understand, and the reason I'm talking about this, is because we need to know that our words carry weight, all right? As sons and daughters of God, whether you know it or not, whether you acknowledge it or not, whether you have tapped into this or not, I want you to understand that your words carry authority. In other words, your words mean something. As a son or daughter of God, your speech ought to reflect God's will. It ought to reflect God's nature because you represent his authority and you are a member of God's family and your values ought to be God's values. So not only is confession a part of salvation, but it is also a part of declaring God's will to those who know it and perhaps to those who don't know it. And to declare God's will, you have to do what? You have to open your mouth and speak it. You have to open your mouth. Well, let me ask you this question, my brothers and sisters. When you are at home, you know, with your families and with your children, let me ask you this question. How do they know what the Lord wants them to do? How do they know that? Do you ever say to them, this is a son what pleases God, a daughter, this is what God wants you to do? Look at here, it says it right here in the word. See, you ought to do that because your children, you know, they may or may not listen to what the preacher is saying. They may or may not get it, but regardless of that, It is your responsibility to reinforce what you hear, and the only way you can reinforce it in the home is to say it. Huh? You ought to say to them, this is what God wants us. And you ought to say things to them like, baby, let me tell you something. This is what God has done for me, right? This is what God has shown me in His Word as it concerns this particular issue. You know, I was struggling with it at one time, but I just went ahead and confessed that to God, and God helped me, and God brought me out. You ought to say to them, this is what God says about how we are to conduct ourselves. This is the direction I believe that God wants us to go in as a family. That is our responsibility, to confess it with our mouths. I want you to right quickly turn to Deuteronomy. Turn to Deuteronomy chapter 6. I think it's going to be up on the screen. Deuteronomy chapter 6, beginning with verse 6. Look at what this says. Now, it's really begins with, love the Lord your God with all your heart, your soul, your mind, and your strength. But then the author says, these commandments, or this word that I give you today, are to be on your hearts. All right? Impress them. First of all, they're in your heart. We just talked about that. Then it goes, take it a step further. Impress them on your children. All right? Then it says, talk about these commandments. Talk about the word. When you sit at home, and when you walk along the road, when you lie down, and when you get up. All right? Tie them as symbols on your hands and bind them on your foreheads. Keep going. Write them on the door frames of your houses and on your gates. In other words, listen, don't only have it in your heart, but talk about it with your children. Talk about it as you walk along the road. Tie these things around your houses, or tie them around your fingers, and write them on the door frames of your houses and on your gates. Sometimes you got to write that thing down, right? But the main thing is that you need to declare what God says, all right? You know, I think we have to become more intentional about articulating or confessing what it is we believe. Because when you say it, when you declare something on behalf of God, more than likely it means that you are committed to that course of action. You know, many times, my brothers and sisters, I believe that we don't say things because we are not really firmly committed to it. Sometimes our silence reflects the fact that we have not yet made up our minds, that we are still thinking and reasoning and pondering on how should we approach a situation. But many times when it comes to the word of God, it's really just a matter of obeying it. You know, sometimes we can reason our way out of not doing what the word of God says. As a matter of fact, we can reason our way into unbelief. What if this happens? What if this doesn't happen, huh? If I say it but I don't do it, then does that mean I'm a hypocrite? You know, all these kind of things can keep us uncommitted, and it can keep us full of excuses. But when you are committed to something, when you have settled that thing in your mind, more often than not, when you are called upon, you will speak it. It will come out of your mouth with conviction. And so, when you confess the word of God, that means that more often than not, you actually believe what you're talking about. I want to show you how important this is. Look at Luke chapter 12, verses 8 and 9. Luke chapter 12, verses 8 and 9. Look at what it says. This is Jesus speaking. He tells His disciples, He says, I tell you, whoever publicly, and that word is confesses me before others, the Son of Man will also confess before the angels of God. Look at that. I tell you, whoever confesses me publicly before others, the Son of Man will also confess before the angels of God. Now you know, that's all Jesus is saying. Listen, if you will confess me before men, when the time comes, I'm going to confess you before the angels of God. Let's look at 1 John chapter 2, verse 23. It's very, very, very important. Confession. Opening your mouth, not hiding
behind your status, not hiding behind your job, but confessing who it is you are in Christ and who you believe. 1 John chapter 2, verse 23, it says, "No one who denies the Son has the Father, but whoever confesses the Son has the Father also." Isn't that something? Let's look at 1 John chapter 4, verses 2 and 3. The Word of God says, this is how you can recognize the Spirit of God. Every spirit that confesses that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is from God. Keep it going. But every spirit that does not confess Jesus is not from God. And he goes on to say that this is the spirit of the Antichrist. Do you see what I'm trying to say? I'm trying to say to you that declaring what it is and who it is you believe in and are committed to is very, very, very important. Let me give you an example of what I'm talking about. You know, if a man really, really likes a woman, at some point in that process, he wants other people to know that. He wants other people to know that she either belongs to him or she is in the process of belonging to him, because he wants to serve notice to the other men that they need to keep it moving when they see her, all right? They need to keep it moving. You know, they can smile at her, you know. They can appreciate her personality. They can appreciate, you know, her charm. But at the same time, don't settle there too long. You got to keep it moving. When a man really likes a woman, he will declare it. So confessing and declaring what you believe is very important. As a son, daughter of God, your words have authority because you represent the Father. And there are times, you know, we ought to just say what God wants you to say. And you got a right to do that. Let me give you an example of this. When we're dealing with temptation of whatever kind, and all of us in here probably deal with some form of temptation every single day. And when we're dealing with the enemy, Jesus confessed the word of God. Look at Luke, the fourth chapter, and we're going to begin with verse 3. This is when Jesus was in the wilderness and he was being tempted by the enemy. After 40 days and 40 nights of fasting, the devil came to him and he said to him right there, he says, "If you are the Son of God, tell this stone to become bread." Keep it going, all right? Jesus answered. What did he answer? How did he answer? He said, "It is written, man shall not live on bread alone." Now, let me tell you something. Jesus quoted the scripture that he lived by. He didn't say, when he was dealing with the enemy or when he was dealing with temptation, he didn't say, "Well, this is what I think." Or, "You know, devil, what you say has some merit, but I believe God wants us to do it this way." He didn't reason with the enemy with his own words, but he used the word of God as a way to attack the enemy. That's how Christ dealt with the enemy. He dealt with the enemy with the word of God. And that's how we are to deal with the enemy as well. So, you know, I know a lot of times, you know, we're here in church and we get lackadaisical about the word. Sometimes I have as well. But I want you to see for yourself that if you're going to deal effectively with the enemy, if you're going to overcome him, if you want to have victory in your life, there are times when you've got to know the word of God and you've got to speak the word of God on his behalf. Let me tell you something. Let's turn to Revelation chapter 12. In Revelation chapter 12, it talks about the fact that we do have the power to overcome the enemy. And one part of it already has been done if you believe in the Lord Jesus. In Revelation chapter 12, I'm going to start with verse 7 just to give you the context of it. But look at what it says in Revelation chapter 12. It says, "Then war broke out in heaven. Michael the archangel and his angels fought against the dragon. And the dragon and his angels fought back. But he was not strong enough, and they lost their place in heaven. The great dragon was hurled down, that ancient serpent called the devil or Satan, who leads the whole world astray. He was hurled to the earth, and his angels with him. Then I heard a loud voice in heaven say, 'Now have come the salvation and the power and the kingdom of our God and the authority of his Messiah. For the accuser of our brothers and sisters who accuses them before our God day and night has been hurled down. But then it says something, even though Michael defeated the enemy and knocked him out of heaven, look at what it says in verse 11. It says, they, talking about us, they triumphed over the enemy. How? By the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony. You see that? They overcame the enemy same way you got to, by the blood of the Lamb. Jesus did his part, and his blood cleanses us from all sins. His blood keeps our sins away from us as far as the east is from the west. But your part is you got to open your mouth and declare your testimony. Look, everybody in here ought to have a testimony. Everybody in here ought to have a testimony if you believe in the Lord Jesus. When I say a testimony, I'm not necessarily talking about a dramatic testimony. I'm not talking about a kind of testimony where you say you're saved from two car crashes and you were thrown out the window and you fell on the sidewalk and you didn't have any scratches and not a bone was broken. That's a good testimony, but I'm not talking about that kind of testimony. All of us as sons and daughters of God have a testimony. And John, 1 John chapter 5, verse 11 tells us basically what our testimony is. Look at what it says. And this is the testimony. God has given us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. That's our testimony right there. That's the basis of he who has the Son has life, and he who does not have the Son does not have life. That's the basic right there. I believe, for example, you ought to say, you ought to know that Jesus died for your sins. And because Jesus was merciful, you ought to tell your children, and you ought to tell your friends, and you ought to tell whoever comes in contact with you that God has been a merciful God, that his mercy is from everlasting to everlasting. You can say, you know what? I once was lost. I once was an alcoholic. I once was somebody who talked about people. I once was a very negative person. I once was a very lustful person. I once was a swindler of people, but God had mercy on me. You know how I know it? Because he died for my sin. You ought to be able to tell somebody that he rose from the dead by the power of God. And because he overcame the enemy, you can overcome the enemy as well. You ought to be able to say, listen, I declare to you, my brothers and sisters, that God has given me victory in this area. And I know it's by the grace and the power of God. You ought to be able to say that. So it's very important, my brothers and sisters, that you confess what the word of God says and confess who it is in whom you believe. Finally, I want you to understand that when you believe this word in your heart, as we talked about in Romans 10, and you confess it with your mouth, all right? That is, that you say what the word of God says. I want you to understand that your confession, the fact that you will open your mouth on behalf of the Lord and speak his word, your confession gives you the power to bring about a change in your circumstances. It gives you the power to bring about a change in your circumstances because you are declaring that God's will be done on this earth as it is being done in heaven. For example, I want you to turn, let's look at Mark chapter 11, verse 22. Look at what Mark chapter 11, verse 22 says. And Jesus says this to his disciples after he spoke to a fig tree, and the fig tree did what he said. We've talked about this before, but look at what he says. He says to his disciples, have faith in God, Jesus answered. Verse 23, okay. He says, truly I tell you, if anyone does what? Says to this mountain. Let's look at it again. Truly I tell you, if anyone does what? Says to this mountain. All right, let's say it like you mean it. Truly I tell you, he says, if anyone does what? Says. In other words, if anyone will speak, if anyone will open their mouth and they say to this mountain, go throw yourself into the sea, and does not doubt in their heart, but believes, go ahead, that what they say will happen, what it will be done for them. Now, there are different things that can be addressed in that particular text. But the main point is that Jesus lets us know that our words are very powerful. Isn't that something? All right, so he said, say to this mountain. Now, I don't know what mountain you have in your life. It might be a mountain of debt. But he says, you ought to have the faith in God, knowing that it is God's will for you, wait a minute, not to be in debt, right? So you ought to begin to speak to that debt. That doesn't mean you don't do anything, but you speak to that debt, or you speak to whatever mountain is hindering in your, as a hindrance in your life, whether it's a mountain on your job, or a mountain in your relationship with your wife, or with your husband, or with your children. You ought to be able to speak to that thing, and if you say it, and you don't doubt it in your heart, but believe that what you say will happen, it says, it will be done for you. So I just come here this morning and say, open your mouth, confess, profess, proclaim your faith in the Lord Jesus. For the Bible says, when we believe it, we will declare it. Too many people have said to me, you know, well, Pastor, I just want you to know that it's in my heart, and Jesus knows my heart. Well, okay, but we don't know your heart or all the things that is in it, right? So the Bible says, it is written, I have believed, and therefore I have spoken. So there are some things that you need to confess publicly, and you ought to let others know where you stand. And when you confess it and you've settled that thing in your mouth and your mind, I'm here to tell you, you will speak it with conviction. It is very important that you have a good confession. Amen. Amen. The doors of the church are open, and we invite you to become a part of us. We're not a perfect church, but we're striving to be all that God would have us to be. So if you don't have a church home, we want to invite you to join this church. But if you've never, of your own volition, given your life to the Lord, if you've never confessed him as Lord, I want to encourage you to do so right now. You can come down that aisle and you can say, I believe that Jesus is Lord. I believe that he died for my sins. I believe that he was raised from the dead by the power of God. And because he had the victory, he will give me the victory as well. I want to encourage you to do that right now. So let's...